Well, it's great to be back in Raleigh to speak to the Raleigh Civil War Roundtable and to see old friends and had a nice supper earlier. I was talking with Ted about the last time I spoke here. I know it was on Braxton Bragg, and I think it was in 2017 or 2018. Sometimes I feel like the man who came out of the store and he's fumbling for his keys in his pocket, his car keys, and he can't find them. And he thought, oh gosh, I've left my car keys in my car in the ignition. My wife has scolded me so many times about doing this. So he rushes out into the parking lot, which is empty. The car is gone. So he figured the car had been stolen. So he immediately calls the police to report his stolen car. Then he calls his wife. He holds that to the end. Call my wife to let her know, honey, I did what you told me not to do. I left the keys in the ignition. The car has been stolen. I've called the police. Will you please come and get me? Long pause. Are you kidding? I dropped you off. Dropped me off? Well, then come and get me. Well, I will as soon as you tell this policeman that I did not steal your car. Chris Fonvielle, how long have you been suffering from forgetfulness? I've enjoyed it most of my adult life. Let me start with a story. When Union forces marched into Wilmington on February 22, 1865, the streets were lined with mostly African Americans, the vast majority, of course, formerly enslaved. Sure, go ahead.
I'm just going to minimize this. Just kind of move this up.
And white unionists, or at least those who had professed to be unionists during the war. One of the young men, a black man in blue uniform, was marching proudly, his rifle musket in hand, his breastplate and his barrel shimmering in the sunlight and the strains of national airs playing, and he's marching up Front Street. Suddenly, this woman rushes out from the sidewalks and jumps into his arms to welcome him home. We don't know the young man's name. His story was included in the Philadelphia Christian Recorder, an African-American-based newspaper. But what we do know is that young man had been enslaved in Wilmington, had escaped. As fate would have it, he joined a United States Colored Troop unit that was part of the Wilmington campaign in 1865. And when he entered Wilmington, the first person to recognize him in the ranks was his mother. And it's such a great story. I wish I knew the details, but it sort of encapsulates the liberation, the freedom at last, that African Americans throughout the region, but for our talk tonight in North Carolina specifically. Now, Wilmington, as you may know, was North Carolina's most populated city in 1860. There were about 10,000 people there. Now, put that into context. During the Ice Age, there were 10,000 Homo sapiens that lived all across Europe. So we would consider that a small town, but by the measure of the Ice Age, it was a relatively small town. It was also the state's busiest seaport. It would become increasingly important, as you know, throughout the war as an entrepot for supplies that were sent from Europe, mostly Great Britain, into the South to help it sustain its war effort in response to Abraham Lincoln's declaration of blockade. The blockade was fairly efficient, ineffective for the first 2.5 years of the war. But as southern seaports started to become heavily blockaded or captured by Union forces, Wilmington became even more important, particularly after Union forces captured and occupied all of eastern North Carolina, with the exception of Wilmington, by the spring of 1862. And of course, the Confederate response to the blockade was blockade runners, Confederate commerce vessels that smuggled supplies in from Europe. This is the USS Advance unloading military supplies. This is North Carolina's own blockade runner that made 17 successful runs through the blockade. A very lucrative trade, both militarily and economically, for the state and for the Confederacy, that helped it fight the war much longer than it otherwise would have. And of course, brought in for the government military supplies that were desperately needed. Wilmington was ideally located for the blockade running trade, being close to neutral transshipment points at Bermuda and Nassau. And after the fall of Eastern North Carolina to Union forces in 1862, the capture of New Orleans, Charleston put under siege in 1863, Wilmington became even more important, and it became the closest major seaport to the Virginia battlefront. Wilmington was located 28 miles up the Cape Fear River, so far out of range of Union naval bombardment, unlike Charleston. And there were dual entryways into the harbor way that provided blockade runners with a choice of entrance and exit at the harbor. So separated by Bald Head Island and Frying Pan Shoals, it was virtually impossible to intercept and stop blockade runners that were bringing in these supplies that were operating mostly at nighttime anyway. And once they got to Wilmington, the supplies were offloaded and then sent by rail to the needy, either on the home front or the battlefront. The most important of the lines of transportation was the Wilmington and Weldon Railroad that ran from Wilmington to Goldsboro to Weldon, North Carolina, where it connected with the Petersburg and Weldon Railroad. And that became Lee's major supply route, known as Lee's Lifeline, eventually the Lifeline of the Confederacy. And my wife always implores me, whenever I tell this story, remind the audience that when the Wilmington and Weldon Railroad, first the Wilmington Raleigh Railroad, renamed in 1852 the Wilmington and Weldon Railroad, that upon its completion in 1840, at 161 and a half miles long, it was the longest railroad in the world. And now it has become the most important supply route for General Lee's army. Now, to protect the rail lines, to protect the port facilities, to protect the river and the inlets for blockade runners, the Confederate government invested heavily in its protection and defense, building a vast network of supplies, of forts and batteries, particularly at the inlets to provide covering fire for the blockade running ships. Next to Charleston, Wilmington was the most heavily defended city along the Atlantic seaboard. Foremost among the fortifications was Fort Fisher, that guarded New Inlet, the northern entryway into the Cape Fear Harbor, that became the most popular entrance for the blockade running ships. Fort Fisher became the largest Confederate seacoast fortification. It was known as the Gibraltar of the South, made entirely of beach sand. It was considered virtually impregnable. And had the war gone on, it would have gotten even stronger. The Union failed in 1862 and 63 to go after Fort Fisher when it was relatively weak, undermanned, and undergunned. Undergunned? Is there such a word as undergunned? You know what I mean. Not well armed. And later, Admiral David Dixon Porter, who commanded the naval task force that captured Fort Fisher in 1865, observed the strength of Fort Fisher, and he said, had we captured this fort, and had we captured Wilmington earlier in the war, as had been proposed after we had captured the Outer Banks, New Bern, Beaufort, all the major river systems, and cities and towns, the war would have ended at least a year earlier and saved hundreds of thousands of lives. Showing you just how significant Fort Fisher was to both the Confederacy and to the Union. Perhaps best reflected by the comment by Secretary of the Navy, whom President Lincoln called Father Neptune, I love that, And he said, to close the port of Wilmington is undoubtedly the most important and effective demonstration that can be made. It is of less, if of less prestige than the capture of Richmond, it would be as damaging to the rebels. I've come to the conclusion that Wilmington was more important than Richmond by late 1864, though Virginians would disagree with me, but I'm, you know, you can be wrong if you're so inclined. But by 1864, General Robert E. Lee said, if Wilmington falls, I cannot maintain his army. The supply route through Wilmington had become that important. The Confederacy, of course, by then had been carved up with only portions of Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, and Virginia still in the game, so to speak. So it is Robert E. Lee and not Chris Fonville who demonstrates just how important Wilmington had become to the South's war effort. If Wilmington falls, I cannot maintain my army. The Union would launch two massive combined operations, today we would call them joint operations, against Wilmington by way of Fort Fisher. The first coming at Christmas 1864, the Union failed to capture the works despite the largest naval bombardment of the war unleashed against the defenses. They returned 2.5 weeks later in mid-January to renew the attack, and after the second largest naval bombardment of the war and the largest combined operation of the war, Fort Fisher finally fell. It was indeed a joint operation. The largest naval task force assembled during the war would bombard from offshore. An expeditionary force went ashore under the protection of the covering fire of the warships. And then late on the afternoon of January the 15th, they would launch an army ground assault that was both Army and Navy. Sailors and Marines from various ships in the fleet would participate. And there was hand-to-hand fighting for about 5.5 hours before the outmanned, outgunned, and exhausted Confederate defenders were forced to surrender. Most of the fighting occurred at night. I recently led a sunset walking tour of Fort Fisher, and that was my first comment. You know, we think that most battles occurred during the daylight, but at Fort Fisher, the vast majority of the fighting occurred after darkness had set in. The fort and the fighters illuminated by the flashes of musketry and the exploding shells from the warships. Mop-up operations were handled by the 27th U.S. Colored Troops, whereas most of the black men in blue had remained further up the peninsula to hold a defensive line against Confederate reinforcements about 4 miles to the north. Now, by 1865, as I'm sure you probably know, about 179,000 young black men, 80% of whom were Southern-born, had joined the United States Army. They fought in 41 major battles, including Fort Fisher, but they would also fight in more than 400 smaller battles, some of which you'll hear me mention tonight. There would be two brigades of U.S. Colored Troops with the Wilmington Expeditionary Forces that attacked Wilmington. 3,300 young black men in blue uniforms, commanded by Charles J. Payne. They included in this order of battle Colonel John W. Ames's brigade. These would be two brigades of the 3rd Division, 25th Army Corps, which had recently been organized under Benjamin F. Butler's command, and this was strictly a black division of troops. Colonel John W. Ames's brigade and Colonel Elias Wright's brigade. And as you can see from the numbers of the regiments, the designations, the unit designations, these were early war units. Most of them were early war units. These were combat hardened soldiers who fought in the expeditionary force, with the expeditionary force at Fort Fisher. The 1st, 4th, 5th, 6th U.S. Colored Troops, 10th, 30th, 39th, 37th, 27th. So these were battle-hardened veterans who were a part of the Wilmington campaign. Among them would be four Medal of Honor winners in waiting. That is, that they had performed daring deeds fighting in southeastern Virginia, for which they would, at war's end, be given the nation's highest military honor. Among them would be Sergeant Major Christian Fleetwood, who would remain in the United States Army at war's end. He was with the 4th U.S. Colored Troops. Corporal Powhatan Beatty with the 4th U.S. Colored Troops. And that young man was from Virginia, escaped slavery, and made his way to Ohio, where the 5th U.S. Colored Troops was organized. And then his fate would have it, came back to the South to fight with the 5th USCT in North Carolina. Now, the U.S. Colored Troops during the Fort Fisher Battle of 1865 held the defensive line at what is today Curry Beach, about 2 miles north of Fort Fisher. But after coming ashore, they established the beachhead, built trenches, and then the white troops would move south to attack Fort Fisher. The black troops remained along the northern defensive line to prevent white Confederate soldiers at Sugarloaf, another 2 miles above the defensive line, from reinforcing Fort Fisher. They were commanded by General Braxton Bragg. The field commander was General Robert F. Hoke, and they failed to reinforce Fort Fisher or to attack the U.S. colored troops in their works to provide relief for the garrison at Fort Fisher that was coming under a heavy attack. But then they would be, the black troops would be, the principal combatants on the east side of the Cape Fear River in the coming Wilmington campaign, that is Union military operations after the fall of Fort Fisher. The white troops had been so badly battered and bloodied in the capture of that fort that they, the commander, Alfred H. Terry, waited until reinforcements could arrive in early February before beginning the assault on Wilmington. Now, of course, the plan was to capture Fort Fisher to close the harbor way to blockade running, which had now occurred. The capture of Fort Fisher closed off New Inlet, that northern entryway into the harbor, but in effect closed off the other entrance further to the south. And no Wilmington-bound blockade running ship could get further upriver, even if they entered through Old Inlet, than Fort Fisher, now that Union forces commanded the lower peninsula of what is today New Hanover County. In those days, that area was called Federal Point. Now, the operations did not end with the capture of Fort Fisher and the closing of the harbor to blockade running. The Wilmington campaign was to cooperate with General Sherman in what we call the Carolinas campaign, or what General Grant called the Northern Expedition. After the capture of Savannah, which occurred at exactly the same time that Union forces failed to capture Fort Fisher in December, Sherman alerted President Lincoln, to whom he sent Savannah as a Christmas gift, notified. Grant was glad to see Sherman safe on the seacoast, planned to transfer his entire 60,000-man legion by sea to southeastern Virginia for one final push against Robert E. Lee's forces, strongly entrenched at Petersburg, if thinly manned. But Sherman, as you know, had other plans. Having successfully marched across Georgia and capturing Savannah, he now proposed to march through the Carolinas to Virginia, destroying in his way, as he had in Georgia, supply caches, railroad depots, rolling stock, cities, anything that got into his way, like an army of army ants. Grant later said that he would have entrusted that movement to no other general officer than William T. Sherman and authorized the expedition to begin. But to ensure its success, Grant wanted to provide Sherman a haven on the seacoast, halfway between Savannah and Petersburg, where he could retreat if he got into trouble, because no one knew what kind of opposition Sherman would face once the Northern Expedition ensued. Or from where Grant could send reinforcements and supplies to Sherman if he could make it to the North Carolina-South Carolina line. Sherman's initial objective was Goldsboro. From Goldsboro, he could go south to capture Wilmington if need be, west to capture Raleigh, or up the Wilmington and Weldon Railroad, which he would sever, to attack Lee's underbelly. It was an ideal strategy that Sherman, not Grant, proposed, but Grant signed on to it. But now, to assure its success, he planned to capture Wilmington. Wilmington became of the utmost importance, so much so that in late January, he traveled from Petersburg, or City Point, his headquarters on the James River, to the Cape Fear to plot and plan the capture of Wilmington to ensure the success of Sherman's northern expedition. And so he was there with Admiral Porter and General Terry, and he authorized the attack on Wilmington, which was to begin as soon as reinforcements arrived from the north. Well, the Union forces had not been idle. They had spent much of late January probing for weak positions or weaknesses in the Confederate defenses along the Sugarloaf lines. Finding none, they launched an all-out assault on February the 11th. So the campaign would begin on February the 11th at Sugarloaf. And leading the assault would be the two brigades of U.S. colored troops. They would be the principal combatants in the Battle of Sugarloaf, fought on February the 11th. The campaign would last 11 days. They did not initially overrun the Sugarloaf defenses. They were repulsed because the Sugarloaf was strongly defended and very, very well built. So you've got heavy defenses, heavy reinforcements, more than 6,400 forces that repulsed the Union attack. And so U.S. colored troops withdrew to about 800 yards from Sugarloaf and threw up their own defenses. A portion of those defenses still exist. It's kind of hard to see them. It's very difficult to capture breastworks on a camera, but here they are. I've got a couple of photographs that I took last winter just to show you that these things still exist. Unfortunately, they're inaccessible. They're on federal property, and there's a big sign right up front that says, "Do not exit your car." But I did anyway, and I got these photographs before security forces from Sunny Point could capture me. Sunny Point's the largest ordnance depot on the East Coast, and they've got heavy security, but I got these works before they got me. So there they are. I think it's neat that they're still there. But finally, under tremendous pressure from Union forces on both sides of the Cape Fear River, and Admiral Porter has put a flotilla of gunboats on the Cape Fear River to provide covering fire for the wings on both sides. General Hoke evacuates Sugarloaf, and the defenses on the west side of the Cape Fear River at Fort Anderson are evacuated, and they retreat northward going towards Wilmington. I don't have a pointer, but I'll give you an idea. Here's Fort Fisher, and you can see where Battery Anderson is right on the shoreline. That's where the Union defensive line was during the Fort Fisher battle, and you can see Sugarloaf 2 miles above that. So when Hoke abandoned the Sugarloaf defenses to retreat northwards toward Wilmington, Fort Anderson, directly on the opposite side of the river, was also abandoned, and Confederate forces would march. The garrison troops there would march up the west side of the river, and that enabled Admiral Porter's flotilla of vessels to ascend the river to continue to provide covering fire for Union forces. The Confederates retreated within 3 miles of Wilmington to a remote location that I call Forks Road. There was a long line of field works built earlier from the Cape Fear River that extended for several miles to the east. And the main road between the lower reaches of New Hanover County to Wilmington ran right through the middle of the earthworks. And the Confederates made a last stand there to try to prevent the onslaught, the juggernaut of Union forces desperately trying to reach Wilmington. And so on February 20th and 21st, the Battle of Forks Road would be fought. It's been the subject of quite a bit of interest recently because a magnificent memorial to U.S. colored troops that fought the battle, and that was Elias Wright's brigade, the 1st, the 5th, the 10th. Those guys fought at the Battle of Forks Road, and an African-American artist named Stephen Hayes did a magnificent memorial to those troops that was recently unveiled at the Cameron Art Museum. So if you're ever in Wilmington, make a point of going by the Cameron Art Museum to see that memorial. But eventually, under heavy pressure, General Hope would abandon the Forks Road lines and retreat towards Wilmington, and then evacuated Wilmington in the early morning hours of February 22nd, George Washington's birthday, by the way. And this really was the last rays of departing hope for the Confederacy. Wilmington had now fallen. Federal troops would enter the city early that morning to much fanfare and celebration among African-American residents and to the professed Unionists who had remained reticent or quiet during the war but now came out to greet the Union forces, and the blacks, of course, saw them as their liberators. So blockade running had ended at Wilmington. The Confederacy was now soon on the verge of collapse, and in fact, 42 days after Wilmington's fall, General Lee surrendered to U.S. Grant. So as he had predicted, if Wilmington falls, I cannot maintain my army. That came to pass. Now, Sherman's northern expedition was successful. By the time he reached Fayetteville in the northern or the upper reaches of the Cape Fear River on March the 11th, Wilmington had been in Union hands for about 2.5 weeks. During Sherman's march, by most estimates, some 20 to 25,000 African Americans had left the farms and plantations along his route and attached themselves to the coattail of his army. So they had escaped slavery. They've now joined the wings or the tail of Sherman's army as it marched north. But they this was fairly typical. Most historians believe that perhaps as many as 500,000 African Americans escaped in the South during the war to make their way to Union lines. One by one, families by families, groups by groups, to wherever Union forces had established their beachheads. The most famous escape in Wilmington was by William Benjamin Gould and seven fellow slaves as part of a great escape during a yellow fever epidemic in Wilmington in the fall of 1862. Mr. Gould and seven fellow slaves launched a boat at the foot of Orange Street and rowed the entire length of the Cape Fear River to freedom. They could not put up a sail, which would have been easily seen by people on shore, and they might have been captured. They rowed furiously, and they were picked up on September the 23rd, so it was about a 36-hour row. They were picked up by the USS Cambridge, and then William Benjamin Gould joined the United States Navy, and his great-grandson published this young man's journal, and his first entry was in defense of the holiest of all causes, liberty and union. I will now join the United States Navy, and he served throughout the war. It's a really fine story. Colonel William Lamb, who was the Confederate commander of Fort Fisher, lost one of his body servants, a man named Charles Wesley, who, like other escaped enslaved people, would provide the Union Navy or Union Army with important military information, troop disposition, defenses, troop strength, and so forth in the lower Cape Fear. So this was a common occurrence, as you well know. By the time Sherman reached North Carolina, the thousands of African Americans had become a hindrance to his military operations. And so on March the 14th, he ordered them to leave the army. Of course, he would go on to fight the Battle of Aviesboro and Bentonville, but he had to shed his army. Not that he didn't care about the fate of the African Americans, it's just that he needed to move. And so he detached them from the army, and they were sent to Wilmington, which of course had been occupied for about 2.5 weeks. By late March, there were somewhere between 8,000 and 10,000 refugees that showed up in Wilmington. So if you can imagine the city that was built to house 10,000 residents, now you've got how many residents remained behind after the evacuation, say half the number of whites, say 5,000. You got 14,500 Union occupation troops, you've got naval personnel, and now you've got 8,000 to 10,000 refugees that have made their way to Wilmington. And it was a very, very difficult situation. There were just not accommodations or supplies to mitigate the suffering that would begin. The United States Army employed blacks, both skilled and unskilled, to do work around the city to rebuild the wharves and docks that had been destroyed during the evacuation. But most of them were deployed to abandoned farms and plantations. And freedmen's colonies were actually established, and the African Americans were encouraged to grow crops. They were white owners, once they had returned to the area, were encouraged to hire blacks to work for them. But African Americans did not enjoy a redistribution of any land in the lower Cape Fear. But many African Americans would join United States colored troop units at Wilmington and Smithville, and then serve as occupation troops or fight for the remainder of the war. But in the aftermath of the war, African Americans focused mainly on building institutions like family, church, and school. This is the Chestnut Street Presbyterian Church, which was actually built in 1858. It became very important as a religious institution to African Americans in Wilmington. And of course, this focus on institution building led to greater political involvement by African Americans. And one of the foremost leaders of those efforts was Abraham Galloway, the subject of a great biography by my friend David Soselsky called Fires of Freedom. If you have not read it, please do. He had been enslaved in Brunswick County near Wilmington, escaped in 1857, lived a Forrest Gump life, but when the war broke out in 1862, he returned to North Carolina and became the most influential, powerful black man in the state. Union occupation forces in eastern North Carolina could do nothing without the authorization of Abraham Galloway. And at war's end, he returned to Wilmington and got involved heavily in civil rights and social justice. He was one of the first African Americans to be elected to the state assembly. He organized the North Carolina State Equal Rights League, the Union League, a very, very influential man during and in the immediate post-war years. Sadly died an untimely death in 1870 of natural causes. So in the post-war years, Wilmington became, in the post-war years, really all the way to the end of the 19th century, Wilmington was considered a mecca of opportunity for African Americans. Social and religious and political institutions had been organized and established and were working. African Americans enjoyed an accumulation of wealth and position and power. They served in various forms of government. Everything was going along just great. Wilmington became a black majority as a result of the war and would remain so until the turn of the 20th century. But everything came crashing down as a result of the riot of 1898. But that's another story for another day. Perhaps Frederick Douglass said it best. As the war for the Union recedes into the past, and the Negro is no longer needed to assault forts and stop rebel bullets, he is in some sense of less importance. Peace with the old master class has been war for the Negro. As the one has risen, the other has fallen. Thank you very much.